Welcome back to our weekly updates. Today, we will cover about New Glenn's third launch, SpaceX's Falcon 9 doubleheader, and ULA's Viasat launch. Let's go. Hey, I'm Lucas. Welcome to the SpaceX community. Let's get started.
Blue Origin just revealed new details about New Glenn's third mission, currently targeted for no earlier than January 2026, which will attempt to deliver the Blue Moon MK1 lunar lander to the moon's surface while reflying the same booster that recently completed its first successful return. Coming shortly after the NG2 mission, this next flight represents a major step not only for Blue Moon's development, but also for New Glenn's push toward consistent reuse. Here, I'll go more in depth into the updated timeline, the state of the NG2 booster, what's known about Blue Moon MK1, and what this upcoming mission means for Blue Origin's long-term goals. The NG2 mission provided the company with valuable data on both ascent and recovery performance. During the landing, New Glenn's booster executed a conservative approach by initially targeting a position several hundred feet away from the Jacklyn landing platform, before shifting over for a slow vertical descent. The final footage showed a stable touchdown, activation of the energetic-weld anchoring system on each landing leg, and minimal charring along the aft structure thanks to the methane-fueled BE-4 engines and the Comet thermal protection coating. The good physical condition of the booster after recovery is one of the primary reasons Blue Origin is preparing it for reflight on the MK1 mission. Engineers are currently evaluating the health of the engines, structural load paths, thermal protection, and weld interfaces to determine exactly how much refurbishment is needed. Early comments from the company indicated that their expectations for refurbishment time were being met, which aligns with the current early 2026 schedule. This turnaround will become increasingly important as Blue Origin works toward a higher launch cadence and reduced per-flight cost, especially as more demanding missions like MK1 come online. Blue Moon MK1 is a central piece of Blue Origin's lunar architecture and is described as the largest lunar lander ever built. Designed to deliver large cargo loads to the lunar surface, MK1 will serve as the first major test of a system intended to support future crew-capable landers and long-term lunar logistics. The vehicle has undergone years of propulsion testing, structural validation, and environmental simulations, but this upcoming flight will be its first full mission profile, from translunar injection through descent and landing. Unlike missions to low Earth orbit, MK1 requires New Glenn's upper stage to perform a series of additional burns, including the major translunar injection maneuver and possibly mid-course corrections before separation. Blue Origin has been incrementally preparing New Glenn's upper stage for these more complex missions. The strong upper stage performance on NG2, which delivered the escapade payload toward Mars, provides some insight into the level of guidance and control accuracy the company is building toward. Even still, MK1 will demand longer engine operation times, higher precision navigation, and multiple days of coast before the lander begins its descent sequence. The lander's propulsion system includes throttleable engines meant to manage lunar deorbit, braking, and soft touchdown. Prior tests of the lander's descent engines have focused on long-duration burns and thermal cycling, but their performance on an actual lunar descent will be a major milestone for Blue Origin. Data from the landing, engine behavior in low gravity, plume, regolith interaction, landing leg deployment, and autonomous hazard detection will be critical for progressing toward future human-rated lunar vehicles. From New Glenn's perspective, the MK1 mission will test the limits of the booster's performance as well. The lander is expected to be heavier than the payload stack on NG2, which means the first stage and upper stage will be operating closer to their designed performance margins. Because of that, Blue Origin is expected to use a slightly more optimized landing trajectory for the booster on its return. After NG2, Jeff Bezos noted that the company would gradually reduce the conservative lateral offset used during landings as engine relight confidence improves. Even a small improvement in propellant use during landing can translate into additional mass delivered toward the moon, making trajectory refinement an important part of the MK1 flight. The significance of this mission also connects directly to NASA's long-term lunar strategy. While this particular flight is not part of the Artemis crewed lander sequence, Blue Moon MK1 is designed to support future commercial and potentially crew-focused variants. A successful MK1 landing would demonstrate that Blue Origin can execute a full lunar delivery profile, validating several mission-critical technologies such as autonomous navigation, deep space propulsion systems, and surface operations. It also helps position the company for future NASA partnerships and commercial lunar infrastructure contracts as the agency prepares for the next decade of surface activity. Looking ahead, Blue Origin has stated that multiple New Glenn boosters are in production, and the manifest includes national security launches, commercial telecommunications missions, and Project Kuiper flights. If the New Glenn 2 booster does successfully return to space on the MK1 mission, it will mark the first instance of stage reuse on New Glenn and help accelerate the program toward regular flight operations. Over the coming months, more updates on MK1's integration, lander readiness, and the specific lunar landing site may be released. For now, the confirmation of New Glenn's third mission and its goal of delivering Blue Moon MK1 highlights an important step forward for Blue Origin and its ambitions in deep space. We will have to wait and see how it progresses and the impact it has on the space industry. Quick update for you all. If you haven't joined our community yet, we'd love to have you. It's completely free, just hit the subscribe button. A few of our members mentioned yesterday that they're not receiving our daily episodes, and I'm not sure what's going on there. So, if you could do us a favor, like this video and make sure your notifications are turned on. Thank you so much, and now, let's get into our next news. Last night marked yet another great milestone by SpaceX, as the company pulled off a tightly packed double play of launches from Florida's Space Coast. The first of the pair lifted off at 10:08 p.m. EST from the historic Kennedy Space Center's Pad 39A, carrying 29 of the company's next-generation Starlink broadband satellites into low Earth orbit. The booster, after completing its mission, touched down gracefully on the drone ship A Short Fall of Gravitas in the Atlantic roughly 8.5 minutes later. Barely 3 hours and 36 minutes later, at 1:44 a.m. EST, a second Falcon 9 launch lifted off from nearby Cape Canaveral Space Force Station with another batch of 29 Starlink satellites. Once its primary role was fulfilled, that rocket's first stage descended successfully onto the drone ship Just Read the Instructions, marking an exemplary night of rapid dual operations. What stands out here isn't just the payloads or the landings, but the cadence. Launching two rockets within such a narrow window underscores SpaceX's growing operational tempo and the maturation of its reusable booster model. This marks the 145th and 146th Falcon 9 missions of the year for the company, each one adding incrementally to the vast Starlink constellation now numbering thousands of satellites in orbit. Of course, the schedule wasn't simply about breaking records. Conditions were near ideal. Weather forecasts for both launches shared a more than 95% chance of favorable conditions, and recent solar activity posed only a moderate risk in the revised evaluations by launch officials. From a broader perspective, these back-to-back launches serve dual strategic purposes. First, they build connectivity infrastructure. Every Starlink batch boosts global broadband capacity, which is increasingly becoming essential in our interconnected era. Second, the sheer frequency and reliability of flights send a strong signal. Rockets are becoming more like commercial operations and less like one-off adventures. The rapid turnarounds, reusable landings, and tight scheduling all point toward an industrialized space launch ecosystem. For observers of the space sector, nights like this are more than launch events. They're milestones in a transition. We are inching away from the era of rare, suspenseful rocket lifts and moving toward one where rockets take off, land, refuel, and fly again, with astonishing regularity. As SpaceX continues to refine the cadence, each night of activity strengthens the foundation of orbit and the infrastructure floating above us. Last night's show may not have broken the absolute fastest turnaround ever. Such a benchmark remains on the books from a pair of launches across states in August 2024. Some 65 minutes apart, but for two launches from the same Florida coast this close together, it sets a fresh standard. In short, Rockets are flying, boosters are landing, satellites are rising, and the pace is accelerating. Anyway, as someone who likes to watch the Falcon 9 booster landings, I'm so glad that we get to experience this almost every day, thanks to SpaceX. And we are on to our next news. On 13th of November, the United Launch Alliance, ULA, successfully launched the second of Viasat next-generation high-capacity Viasat 3 broadband satellites toward geostationary orbit aboard an Atlas V rocket from Cape Canaveral. The mission marks a major step forward for Viasat's ambition to deliver terabit-class capacity across the globe, enabling large-scale broadband connectivity via space. According to reporting, the satellite separated from the upper stage about 3.5 hours after launch, beginning its phased orbit-raising maneuvers and gradual commissioning sequence. The mission encountered a number of launch scrubs prior to liftoff, highlighting the complexity of aligning payload readiness, launch vehicle performance, and fair-weather windows. With this second satellite launched, Viasat is now closer to realizing its vision of a three-satellite Viasat 3 constellation that will underpin ultra-high-throughput connectivity in the Americas and other regions. The company's earlier statements indicate that each Viasat 3 craft is designed to deliver more than 1 terabit per second of network capacity, a benchmark that would mark a transformative leap in commercial satellite broadband. For ULA, the mission underscores the Atlas V's ongoing value in launching large commercial communication satellites, even as the launcher advances toward retirement in favor of next-generation vehicles. For Viasat, the satellite is both a strategic addition to its network and a technology demonstration of the future of broadband from space. As the spacecraft undergoes orbit raising and payload activation over the coming weeks, industry watchers will look for indications of throughput performance, beam steering, and commercial service rollout timing. With terrestrial infrastructure still unable to reach many remote and underserved markets, this orbital launch offers a tangible path toward closing the digital divide gap from high above the OS.
Thanks for watching today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another great video tomorrow.